Today we will discuss viral hepatitis. The key learning objectives for this presentation include 1. To review different types of viral hepatitis. 2. To review clinical presentation, diagnosis, and management of various types of viral hepatitis. The major focus of this presentation will be on hepatotrophic viruses with hepatitis A, B, C, D, and E. We will briefly discuss some of the non-hepatotrophic viruses, such as EBV, CMV, HSV, and others. First, let's start with hepatitis A. The virus is transmitted fecal-orally, and it is a positive, single-stranded RNA virus of the picornavirus family. Patients typically present with a prodromal symptoms, such as myalgia, arthralgia, fever, anorexia, and diarrhea of 2 to 4 weeks after consumption of contaminated food or water. This is followed by jaundice and tea-colored urine. However, there's low risk of chronic liver disease, and the symptoms typically resolve within weeks, with full resolution of liver function within approximately 2 months. Hepatitis A infection is diagnosed based on the positive anti-HAV IgM antibodies. Immunization against hepatitis A can provide protection for up to 10 years. Travelers to areas of poor sanitation where risk of fecal-oral contamination is high should be advised on immunization. Moving on to hepatitis B. This virus could either be transmitted parenterally or through a maternal-fetal route. It is a double-stranded DNA virus, part of the orthohepatinavirus family. The clinical presentation of hepatitis B depends on whether the patient has acute or chronic hepatitis B. Patients with acute hepatitis B typically present with prodromal symptoms 30 to 180 days following exposure, followed by jaundice and tea-colored urine. In immunocompetent individuals, the hepatic inflammation resolves spontaneously with the development of anti-HBs antibodies. However, in 5 to 10% of the patients, the disease may progress into a chronic hepatitis B infection. Patients with chronic hepatitis B are often asymptomatic and are detected based on abnormal liver function tests. Risk factors for chronic hepatitis B include a positive family history of hepatitis B, high-risk sexual behavior, history of IV drug use or blood transfusions and needle-stick injuries in the healthcare professionals. The risk of a progression to chronic liver disease depends on the immune status of the infected patients. Children who acquire hepatitis B via perinatal transmission and in the first 5 years of life have a 95% risk of progression to chronic hepatitis B due to the lack of an adequate immune response to the virus at the time of the infection. Conversely, immunocompetent adults who acquire the infection through blood transfusions or sexual exposure have a low, roughly 5% risk of progression to chronic hepatitis B. In order to diagnose hepatitis B, we need serologic markers and the combination of those results to tell us whether the patient has hepatitis B. Let's start with a review of what each of the serologic markers suggest. HBsAg is a surface antigen to hepatitis B, suggests carrier state. HBsAb, which is the surface antibody, suggests immunity. HBcAb is the antibody to the core antigen, suggests current or prior infection. HBeAg is the antigen to the envelope, suggests infectivity. HBeAb, which is the antibody to the envelope antigen, suggests low transmissibility. On the right, we have a figure taken from CDC to help us put everything together. For example, if the markers are negative for hepatitis B surface antigen, the anti-hepatitis core antibody, and the anti-hepatitis B surface antibody, then the patient is susceptible to hepatitis B. In the second example, if the markers are negative for hepatitis surface antigen, but are positive for both anti-hepatitis B core and anti-hepatitis B surface antibodies, then the patient is immune to natural infection. In the third example, if the patients are negative for both hepatitis B surface antigen as well as anti-hepatitis B core antibody, but positive for anti-hepatitis B surface antibody, then the patient is immune due to hepatitis B vaccination. In the fourth example, if the patient's markers are positive for hepatitis B surface antigen, anti-hepatitis B core antibody, as well as IgM anti-hepatitis B core antibody, but negative for anti-hepatitis B surface antibody, then the patient has an acute infection. If the patient has markers that are positive for hepatitis B surface antigen as well as anti-hepatitis B core antibody, but negative for both IgM anti-hepatitis B core as well as anti-hepatitis B surface antibody, then the patient is in a chronic infected state. In the final example, if the markers are negative for hepatitis B surface antigen, positive for anti-hepatitis B core antibody, but negative for anti-hepatitis B surface antibody, then the interpretation is unclear, and there are four possibilities. Either one, the patient has resolved infection, which is the most common and likely answer, or two, there's a false positive anti-hepatitis B core antibody, meaning the patient is susceptible, or three, there's a low-level chronic infection, or four, there's a resolving acute infection. Moving on to the treatment plans for hepatitis B virus, let's start with the goal of treatment, which is to prevent progression and complications of chronic liver disease, such as cirrhosis and HCC. There are several groups who should be treated, and they include 1. Acute liver failure patients or patients who show clinical complications of liver cirrhosis, and 2. Hepatitis B envelope antigen positive or hepatitis B envelope antigen negative patients with chronic hepatitis. The treatment options include pegylated interferon, which stimulates the immune system to mount a response to clear the HBV virus. Pegylated interferon is contraindicated for patients with decompensated disease as it carries a risk of precipitating liver failure. Other options include nucleoside or nucleotide analogs such as entecavir and tenofovir, which interrupts replication of the HBV virus to reduce the viral load and hepatic necrosis inflammation. Moving on to hepatitis C, which is transmitted parenterally and is a positive single-stranded RNA part of the Flaviviridae family of viruses. Acute hepatitis C is often subclinical, and most patients present with chronic hepatitis C, which is asymptomatic and diagnosed based on screening blood tests. Patients often have high risk for multiple sexual partners, maternal-fetal transmission, IV drug users, or healthcare professionals. The progression to chronic liver disease is around 70%. With a high risk of eventual liver cirrhosis and HCC. Patients can be diagnosed with HCV RNA or anti-HCV markers, and treatment for chronic HCV infections include interferon, ribavirin, or sibosfovir. Moving on to hepatitis D, which is transmitted parenterally and depends on HBV because HDV is a superinfection of hepatitis B. This is a negative single-stranded RNA virus, part of the Delta virus family. Clinical symptoms are the same as hepatitis B, with similar management plans as well. Patients are diagnosed via the Delta antigen. Moving on to hepatitis E, which is transmitted orofecally and is a positive single-stranded RNA virus of the hepivirus family. It presents similarly to hepatitis A, which is typically self-limiting, but it does carry a higher risk of fulminant liver failure, especially in pregnant women and immunocompromised patients. In terms of the diagnosis and management plans, prevention is a key through proper sanitation. For acute HEV infections, the best available treatment is supportive treatment. The goal of this slide is to show that non-hepatotrophic viruses may also involve liver injury in the context of generalized viral infection. Some of the classes of viruses that could lead to liver damage include herpes viruses, which is the most common non-hepatotrophic viruses and includes HSV, CMV, and EBV. For HSV hepatitis, it usually presents in very ill immunocompromised patients associated with typical herpetic skin rash. In CMV hepatitis, it is difficult to diagnose and requires a high index of suspicion in immunocompromised patients diagnosed via CMV, PCR, or liver biopsy. EBV hepatitis usually presents in young patients with infectious mononucleosis with EBV infection and is often self-resolving. Other viruses include adenoviruses, enteroviruses, paramyxoviruses, togaviruses, arboviruses, arenoviruses, filoviruses, proxyviruses, as well as coronaviruses. In summary, hepatitis A and E are transmitted via fecal-oral transmission with lower risk of chronic liver disease. On the other hand, hepatitis B, C, and D are parentally transmitted or vertically transmitted with higher risk of chronic liver disease, liver cirrhosis, and hepatocellular carcinoma. Other etiologies of viral hepatitis include EBV, CMV, HSV, and HIV. Here are some of the key references used in this presentation. And special thanks to Dr. Jason Chang for his help in preparation of this presentation. Thank you very much for listening.